Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. February is National American Heart Month. I think I got that right. American Heart Month. And since that is the core of our health, I thought I'd focus on that today. A little bit of what happens in situations when people have trouble with their heart, and then some of the things to do to try to avoid those situations. Joining us is Bob Ellington, who has been an EMS educator and a paramedic since the 1970s. My first acquaintance with a heart attack came when neighbors were, my parents' age, were stricken, and all of a sudden the police and the fire would come to the house and have to rescue them, sometimes for the better, sometimes not so much for the better. And so I thought we'd just start off by saying, what happens when it all goes wrong, Bob? The paramedic, what happens when you're called to a house?
Well, over the years, one of the things that we've learned is it really takes a team to be successful in a resuscitation or to deal with somebody who's having a heart attack. We've kind of learned that. For many years, we put a lot of energy into training the police department to know what to do in the first few minutes, the fire department first responders to know what to do in the first few minutes, the EMS personnel, whether they're emergency medical technicians or paramedics. I'm a paramedic. What our job typically is we come in and we make a quick assessment of what's going on. Sometimes, for example, we may have a conscious person who's having chest pain, who maybe is having difficulty breathing. Maybe they'll describe that they have numbness going down their left arm and the pain's going into their up into their neck. That might be a typical description that we might have out of a male patient. Ironically, with female patients, the description of someone who's having a heart attack is vaguer than that. They have vague symptoms. They may have nausea. They may have be sweaty, a rapid pulse or an irregular pulse, and just this sensation of doom. And so, you know, a lot of times it's our job to pick up on those things very quickly. Typically what we'll do is we'll put the person in a position of comfort. We'll get a set of vital signs on them. We will often begin to give them some oxygen. Many times, provided they don't have any allergies, we may give them some aspirin. We may inquire as to whether or not they're on nitroglycerin. Some patients have previous history. They are prescribed to take nitroglycerin, so in that situation, we may assist them in taking their nitro, provided their blood pressure is appropriate.
But it's a complicated situation. It requires somebody who's been through this to make some quick judgments as to...
Absolutely, absolutely. But as I say, it requires a team, and the first person on the team are the people who are there. So it might be commonly a spouse or a family member or a son or daughter. They need to know immediately to call 911, and they need to be able to get on the phone with the dispatcher and provide some information. Many times the dispatchers will walk them through. An ambulance has already been dispatched, but in the meantime, they keep them on the phone, and they'll provide some additional information. If it's a worst-case scenario where the patient has, passed out, gone unconscious, basically, we're encouraging that the general public learn how to do CPR. We've made that simpler. Every 5 years, they revise things. This version of CPR we have now is the simplest it's ever been.
Well, so. I realized that. I was looking through the instructions, and what I learned as a lifeguard down in the South Shore of Nassau doesn't necessarily follow what you people can do now.
Well, it's interesting. The irony is what you learn.
That was before my hair turned gray.
and me too. What you learned years ago, though, is a lot of that still stays with you. And what you learned was you got to get help right away, and you got to start doing some things. Okay?
Well, now we have defibrillators, which supposedly makes things easier.
Out in a lot of public buildings, in fitness centers, In the schools in our state, we have defibrillators that are out supposed to be in clearly posted areas. So if you have somebody who dropped in front of you, you would assure that someone's calling 911 and send somebody to go get the defibrillator while you begin chest compressions. When the defibrillator arrives, most of them are very, very simple today. I mean, you literally just open it up. It's 1, 2, 3, follow this, and they talk to you. They talk you through it. So that can make a world of a difference in the initial resuscitation of a patient. Now, as I said, as a paramedic who responds, sometimes we'll respond to somebody's home and nobody's really done anything except called us. So in those situations, we're not thrilled about that. We'll do everything we can, and we'll bring the patient to appropriately trained emergency department personnel. But the chances of survival are not that great. On the other hand, when I arrive at somebody's house and somebody is already doing CPR, if it's a cardiac arrest, the chances for survival are that doubles, if not triples, the chance of survival. Just the fact that a family member or a bystander stepped up and knew what to do.
So getting more and more people to know CPR is a very valuable thing.
Absolutely.
And are they teaching this in the schools? I know there's been people want to have it mandated, but I also was under the impression that many of the schools are doing this on a voluntary basis.
Well, technically what we really want to do is we want to make it possible.
Yeah.
For all the schools to share the psychomotor skills of CPR with all of their students. We want to make that possible because at this point in time, the skill is so simple that it really wouldn't take much more than 20-30 minutes out of the entire school year.
Well, as I learned, though, being a lifeguard, it's not just a skill, but in the immediacy of the situation, having the self-awareness that you should apply those skills.
Right.
And try to get rid of the, because not only is a person who's going through a heart attack getting some trauma, but everybody around them is getting a rush of adrenaline trying to figure out what to do.
Mm-hmm.
And keeping that calm is the whole thing.
Sure, sure. Being
now,
able
you,
to.
You've been involved in this since the 70s, but you've also taken it on to take the life lessons of what you've seen in person and start to become an advocate with the American Heart Association. And so I thought we'd explore a little bit of what you've been teaching and lecturing about, some of the steps that people should do for a healthy heart, some of the things to look out for.
Well, actually, the physician who trained our paramedic program, the one I took many years ago, basically told us this is part of your responsibility as a paramedic because no one else is going to do this. So you really need to train the general public and help them understand what to do. I think it's important that people understand the signs and symptoms of a heart attack. All right. I think it's important that they learn CPR. But, those are after the fact. Okay.
Yeah.
Prevention is really the key to all of this. And only within the last couple of years have we actually defined health in terms of 7 different criteria that, they utilized all the scientific research and defined health. And the definition of health has to do with a number of things. Things like whether or not you smoke, okay? I mean, clearly, that's maybe not an easy thing to fix for someone who's addicted to smoking, but at the same time, there are solutions to that, okay? What somebody's blood glucose level is or blood sugar level is, okay? There are, dietary ways of controlling that and getting a handle on that. What somebody's blood pressure is, all right? You got to know what it is before you can fix it, so you have to keep an eye on it. What your weight is. People should get up every single morning and say, when they step out of the shower, step on the scale. So they focus and have a handle on what their weight is. And they need to know what normal weight is for their body, for their height. You can work on that if you know what it is and what normal is. Other factors that are useful that people should know about, clearly, They should be well aware of what they're eating, okay? I mean, there's been so much out there to basically tell people, you know, stop with all the salt. They really ought to be eating more fruits and vegetables. You know, when you fill your plate up, you probably ought to fill half your plate up, and half of it ought to be colorful with fruits and vegetables, okay?
It's the trouble is too many people don't like the colorful fruits and vegetables.
Yeah, well, there's so many choices out there, they have to find a couple that they like, yeah. You know. So these are all things. And then, of course, exercise, all right? We have to get our society back into the situation where everybody's up and moving. Everybody's up and moving, not just sitting on the couch with the clicker, okay? You know, and you got to make the time in your life to do it, okay? You know, I run my 5 every day, all right? And I'll tell you, there are some days where it's difficult to find the time to do that, but you got to do that. That's the only way you can get a handle on these. So the solutions are out there. It's just helping people understand what the solutions are to better health. If we can get people to improve their health, we won't be in this situation years down the road where we'll be frantically trying to figure out how to tell them what to do for heart attacks and strokes and all those
things. Well, interestingly, difficulties with the heart form the core of so much else that's wrong with our health. Mm-hmm. And if we could address that, we could save both our individual stresses a great deal as we get older, and then we could save society billions of dollars so we don't have to pay attention to people who have congestive heart failure and continue to go in and out of emergency rooms and things like that. That is one of the most preventable types of problems in all of the design of outcomes for health.
Absolutely. You're right on the mark there. And you know, it's such a big problem that there are solutions for. There's 800,000 people every year who die from heart disease. That's one every 36 seconds.
And we often associate it with just males. But I'll never forget when I was at a lecture at Cold Spring Harbor by one of their annual major lecturers who was talking about genetic disposition towards heart disease. And he made the comment that as soon as a woman is past menopause, her risks for heart disease are the same as males. And literally, since the audience was half women, that half of the audience sat right up at the edge of their seats because they had been somewhat complacent in their lives. But you have to do it. It's something that hits both sexes, and that's why we have the pins for Wear Red for Heart Health in February.
Certainly. And to make people more aware of the fact that heart disease affects women very significantly. Basically, in respect to the causes of death, you can add up all the causes of the death of the next 4 or 5 major causes of death, and they don't even come anywhere near the total cost of death for heart disease with women. So, you know, it's a very significant problem. What's the hard part about this is with women, their symptoms are vague. So it's not on you. With a man's often, not always, but often, they'll develop crushing chest pain. And, you know, it's a little bit harder to rationalize that away. And, you know, you do get involved in the EMS medical system. But with the women, you know, they're very, very busy. They're running everything. You know, they got to deal with the kids. Many of them are in the workforce. They got a million things going on. So they have these vague symptoms going on for the last few days. And it's easy for them to just rationalize them away.
Bob, I told you in the last minute we'd really start to get into an interesting conversation, but we're going to have to draw this to a close.
Sure.
So I thank you for taking the time. Thank you for all your work as a paramedic. Very important. And I thank you for tuning in. In a month that has Valentine's Day, we celebrate the heart. We celebrate heart health. I thank you for joining with me today, and I'll see you again next time.